wealth, we try hard to earn it back. Likewise, like dhanarjana and what we are getting into swastya by means of regaining our health. Likewise, we have to regain the health of our land is Sanskrit. The wealth of our land is Sanskrit. The spiritual pulse of our land is Sanskrit. Likewise, the treasury of knowledge, wealth is Sanskrit. So we should try our level best to bring it back. And this is known as Mrutavada. Then they are also saying a lot of other explanation, like whether it is Deva Vishayika Bhasha or Devahi Bhashita Bhasha, innumerable such conferences and discussions, debates and dialectical studies and explorations are going on. Like that, they are also saying that it is a Prakriti Virodha or Prakriti Virodhaka. Now it is the nature of the world that it is dealing with various other evolutions in the form of, it is known as Sankana Yuga. It is information technology, biotechnology, nanotechnology, cognitive technology. It is space exploration era. It is the era of space colonization. It is the era where we are trying to bring elixirs and avoid death and produce longer longevities. So at this era of hyper development and hyper involvement, getting into Sanskrit is a reciprocation or retrogression. It is known as Pragati Virodha. Somebody says like that. And somebody claimed that Sanskrit is the warehouse of all superstitions, as it brings everything into mantra, devata, upasana, siddhi, anushtana. All of these things are aprakrita and adrita. That which is impalpable and unintelligible. So it is the duty of each and every Sanskrit person to say that it is not a Brahmanya Bhasha, it is not a Mrita Bhasha, it is indeed veritably a Deva Bhasha, it is Prakriti Sadhaka, not a Nirodhaka, and it is very much essential to eradicate superstition, not to implant superstition inside. It is the duty of the learned persons who are multilingual, multidimensional, multiversified to implant these ideologies in the society. Now coming to the point of Prayojana, Prayojanam Anuddishya Namantopi Pravartate. There must be a Prayojana, number one. One is Aihika Prayojana. Unless we have, there are some group of people in Sanskrit who are just research scholars working in American universities, vice chancellors, pro chancellors, and some heads of the department, they are well paid. Then next, to those people who are well established, for the common person, what is the use of Sanskrit in Aihika? A normal materialistic view, what we can get? Can we get a Patavi? Can we get Aishwarya? Can we get Khyati? So for reputation, for establishment, financial settlement, they used to compare always with IT professionals, electronic engineering, their doctors and the various other professionals that are there in the society. A common person, a common mind used to always compare themselves with those people. So for that comparison, Sanskrit is still appearing to be insufficient, inadequate or redirected to some other path of mystic doctors. So we have to make clearly understand that there are lots of opportunities. A real Sanskrit person should understand opportunities, make others to understand opportunities, create new opportunities, direct those people for new projects, emerging projects. I believe that Sanskrit has more projects than BPOs, KPOs and WPOs. But it should be properly entrusted to people by means of a reasonable direction. So the second thing is Amushpika. What is Amushpika? Transcendental. Getting knowledge, getting emancipation, getting self-realization. Nobody is interested in that. Even the great Brahmins, that's what I told. Most of the Purohit's children, they are into business. And most of the Vaidikas, they are having the children who are nowhere distinguishable from Vaideshikas. So it has the tradition, even Amushpika tradition has been lost at all. Number third thing, Yoga, Ayurveda and various other essential sciences are there. That is a very big problem. It is known as Anuvada Vikaraha. In order to understand three things, one, understand the value of language, number two, understand the value and stuff of the contents of the treatise, number three, by which it can instigate and stimulate a small spark by which the person can go into research of Sanskrit and Shastra, Anuvada has been made. Translation facilitates only understanding the glory of the language and understanding the glory of the discipline. But the same translation, now if I ask somebody to study about Bhagavad Gita and Sanskrit, they say that it is available in our regular translation. Why to go for the risky process of learning Sanskrit? So translation has been made to facilitate more apprehension in Sanskrit, to understand the originality of the language, to understand the madhuri of the language. It has been given to people. But it has been misdirected to the society that it has been the major reason for avoidance of reading Yoga, Ayurveda, Bhagavad Gita, everything available in translations. So it is avoided. This is known as Anuvada Nyaya. So this Anuvada totally differentiates everything. And the final thing what I want to say is, apart from this, there is Vaijnanika Parampara and there is Naitika Parampara. In Naitika ethics also there are three accusations. One, ethics need not be in Sanskrit, like honesty, purity, loving everybody. It is available in all religions. All ethical principles are available in all religions, number one. Ethics need not be a part or component of religion. It is a part of normal education itself. Education and this ethics are normally coupled together. So if you want people to go for yoga ayurveda, they say about translation. If you want to go to the people for Naitika Shikshana, they are pointing out these things, like Naitika Shikshana is available in all religions. It is available even in educational texts like Aesop fables and other stories. Number three, even without being governed or intuited to the people, still by a normal, mature, civilized person, they can understand ethics without the use of Sanskrit. So these are the accusations. So ethics also has rejected Sanskrit. And in Vijnana, there are four main accusations. Number one is Nirupana. In most of the things like the Vaimanika Shastra and various other things, most of the things are not available. They are having a different hospitality, Paribhashika Prakara, by which we cannot understand what they are. It is very difficult also to prove those things. That is a problem. And second thing is Arhata. In the normal education, it does not implant any Arhata. Whereas in traditional wisdom or our Vijnana, it gives lot of availabilities for the person to practice. Acharya Pratipatti, Devata Vishwasaha, Krama, Brahmacharya, Diksha, Achara, Niyama, Anushthana, innumerable bindings are there, without which a person cannot get that benefit at all. And Pratiyogita is also there. For example, if you take our astronomy, not only we have dealt with gravity, the sun's motion, orbit, axis, light year and travel of light, everything we have mentioned. But still, whatever, there is a growth in modern scientific industry, that is Vartamana, Vriddhi, Pravriddhi. So it is growing and ever growing, whether it is correct or not, experiments are done, verifications are done. So the empirical dynasty of the lineage is growing, whereas Aryabhatta, Bhaskaracharya, that has a stagnation. And nobody is there in the contemplative parampara, that is Upasana parampara, to continue it in part with the homogeneity of the status of Bhaskaracharya, Aryabhatta. We are now just scholars. So sages, they were existing, then the seers, they came, then came the saints, then came the scholars. Now we are having just students and teachers. So that parampara has been lost at all. So what we want to say is, even in Vijnana, we are not in complementary to all of these things. So we have to understand our loopholes and we have to fill it with property. And there are two paramparas which I want to say, somebody may be against it. It is known as Parivartana Dvikam. If you follow Vesha and Bhusha, you will enter into Bhasha. If you follow your Bhasha, you will enter into Vesha and Bhusha. It will make a person to fit into everything. That is what I feel and Shastras have said. If you follow a language without having a strong base of your culture, I am saying, there are also a lot of mithyacharas in the traditional dress and satyacharas in the different dress, that is apavada, exception. But generally what I want to say is, the dress code leads you to language, language leads to a culture, culture leads to habits, habit leads to mannerisms, mannerisms lead to behaviorism, behavior leads to character, characteristics leads to cultural collapse. So Veshabhusha, at least in our tradition, at least in pujas and everything, we have to practice, because our dress code, our language, our culture, our morality, our deity and the great glorious land of Bharat, everything are the components of the same tattva. We cannot have any separability or